Now we will cover the important parameters that affect the functionality of all VREFs. Note that not all parameters are affected equally or necessarily interdependent, but the overall performance will be directly impacted by the environment and input conditions. Initial accuracy is the reference error compared to the nominal output voltage. This is typically specified as a percentage. Initial error is normally defined under a strict set of operating conditions. The specific test conditions will vary from device to device, but it is important to know that deviating from these conditions may lead to additional error. The table on the right provides a guideline to understand the magnitude of the error. For example, an error of less than 0.1% is typically thought of as a high accuracy device, whereas a 1% error is a lower accuracy device. Note that the importance of initial accuracy depends mainly on whether or not the data acquisition is calibrated, as a calibrated system can compensate for the error introduced due to initial accuracy. Let's look at an example of this specification for the LM4040. For this device, the nominal voltage is 2.5 volts and the initial accuracy is 0.1%. Taking 0.1% of 2.5 volts yields 2.5 millivolts, which means that the reference voltage can vary from 2.4975 volts and 2.5025 volts due to initial accuracy. But remember that initial accuracy is defined under a set of strict conditions, so any changes in temperature, supply voltage, or current load can affect the accuracy. Next, we can take into consideration the shift in the reference voltage due to changes in ambient temperature. Temperature drift is often considered one of the most important parameters, as it is very difficult to correct this error through calibration. The temperature coefficient, or drift, is usually specified in parts per million, or ppm, per degree Celsius. We can calculate the coefficient by using the full temperature range and obtaining the maximum and minimum reference voltages as can be seen in the formula. The graph on the right shows us that the temperature drift is nonlinear and that instantaneous drift may be higher in some areas than in others. Thus, the temperature coefficient can be thought of as the average drift across the entire temperature range. Since the drift looks at the entire temperature range and the maximum reference variation, it creates a box around the reference variation. For this reason, this calculation method is called the box drift calculation. It is important to note that different grade devices will have different temperature coefficient based on their reference voltage deviation and operating temperature range. Unlike the temperature drift, the thermal hysteresis is a shift in performance that occurs when a device's cycle through temperature extremes, much like the temperature cycle on the right. Let's assume for a moment that a voltage reference output is measured at room temperature. The reference is then subjected to hot and cold extremes, and finally, the reference is brought back to room temperature. You might assume that the voltage reference output would return to the initial output measured before the temperature cycle, but it will not. The reason that it does not return to the same output value is that the device was subjected to inelastic stress. The stress from temperature cycle, called thermal hysteresis, will cause a shift in the operating performance of the device. The amount of thermal hysteresis is normally specified in the device datasheet. Another effect that can cause the reference output to shift is the long-term stability of the device. Long-term stability is sometimes referred to aging, because the performance of the device will change across time. This is meant to give the designer a rough idea of the stability of the voltage reference over the life of the application. The prevailing wisdom is that the majority of the shift in voltage reference occurs in the first 1,000 hours, as long-term stability is related logarithmically with time. Both thermal hysteresis and long-term stability are often referred to as device non-repeatability, because they refer to changes in the nominal output of the device. Next, we will cover noise. Reference noise is a random variation in the output voltage of the reference. This noise is inherent to the design of the device and can only be minimized through filtering. Most often, there are two main categories of noise specification in a voltage reference datasheet. Low frequency noise, also referred to as flicker noise, is focused in the frequency range below 10 Hz. This value is typically represented as a peak-to-peak voltage. The low frequency aspect is important because it means that the noise is not easy to filter out. On the other hand, wideband noise is specified above 10 Hz and can be more easily filtered out. This value is typically represented as nanovolts per root hertz or RMS voltage. Since the noise from the reference is often related to the remainder of the circuit in an application, some series voltage references, such as TI's REF50XX family, include an additional noise reduction feature. This can further improve the performance and the precision of the voltage reference. Power consumption, however, will differ between topologies. In general, a series voltage reference will consume less power than a shunt voltage reference. This is due to several factors. First, a series voltage reference draws the current needed by the system plus a quiescent current. Often, this quiescent current can be small, so the series reference current consumption will be low for light loads and will increase for heavier loads. The shunt reference, on the other hand, must be configured to supply the peak current required for the application. So the total current drawn by the shunt reference will be the same for both light and heavy loads. Additionally, some series voltage references, such as TI's LM41XX family, have an enable pin that shuts the reference down when it is not being used. While in shutdown mode, the reference draws almost no current. Nevertheless, there are many applications where shunt references can have very low power consumption also. This is because they operate with very low minimum current and can be adjusted depending on the design. So if the load current requirements are low, a shunt reference can often be configured for low power. Overall, different applications will have different power consumption requirements, so understanding these differences can be critical. Now that we have all the important parameters listed out, we can estimate the total error or accuracy of the voltage reference. When calculating the total error in a voltage reference, it is helpful to separate the specifications where a maximum value is guaranteed, such as a temperature coefficient, initial accuracy, low regulation, and line regulation, from those where only a typical value is provided, such as the 0.1 Hz to 10 Hz noise, thermal hysteresis, and long-term stability. It is best practice to calculate the effect of the parameters during full operation, such as load, temperature, voltage, and others, to ensure a worst-case calculation. It is worth noting that the statistical methods through which the guaranteed maximum specifications are calculated vary by manufacturer, so comparing datasheets may not tell the full story. Jocelyn will now explain where you can learn more about voltage references and TI's devices.
All right, thanks so much, Jose. Thank you all for watching this VREF training, and be sure to check out TI's resources on ti.com/VREF. Here you can find detailed white papers on VREF selection basics and topology comparisons, application notes, and blogs on the topic from our E2E or Engineer to Engineer forum.